Well, you'll be shocked to know we're leading off this morning with more juvenile violence. A 15-year-old shot and killed in West Baltimore, Sandtown, Winchester. This is at 4:30 in the afternoon yesterday. Police got a report of gunshots. They found this kid suffering from what they called life-threatening gunshot wounds. Took him to the hospital. He died in the hospital. This is at the Gilmor Elementary School. It's not closed. Yep. It's also the same place where the Lillian Jones Recreation Center is located, or was located, because it's closed now as well.
And you know why that rings a bell?
Well, because a 13-year-old, Malia Turner, was killed there 2 years ago. Almost 2 years ago to the month.
Still haven't found her murderer, by the way.
So here we go again. 15-year-old, no suspects. Police, you know, asking for help and determining who killed this 15-year-old boy in West Baltimore. Meanwhile, another incident at Dunbar High School, where a male juvenile apparently shot himself in the parking lot. Did not tell police that immediately when police got there, but they determined that it was a self-inflicted wound. He has survived, but that's the
third shooting
at Dunbar, or related to Dunbar activities, because you can't say necessarily the football game was at Dunbar. But yeah, three incidents involving Dunbar High School this school year.
But you can say that the story that we did about a gun, somebody playing with guns or whatever, and shot through the window at the cafeteria.
Yeah.
That was at Dunbar.
Oh,
the other one
was
off the actual football field at Dunbar. So technically, that was more of a neighborhood beef. But still, the point, Bryan, is these are juvenile. By the way, that shooting was a 12-year-old that was shot in the shooting that was off the football field site. What we're talking about at the center of all this are juveniles with guns every week or every few days or whatever it may be.
Yep.
And I believe the number now is 14. 14 young people under the age of 17 and under have been killed. Scores more wounded since the beginning of this year. And at the same time, everybody, an 18-year-old yesterday, he's now 18, he was 17 at the time, last September the 2nd, if you remember the tragedy, as a young football player at Mervo. At the time, Mervo was number one, I think, in football then, is walking out of school, the first day of school, I believe it was, Bryan, and he walks out and he's shot and killed in broad daylight by another Baltimore City Public Schools student in front of everybody, school police, everybody was there. He shot and killed the 17-year-old. Well, that 18-year-old now was convicted yesterday of the murder of the 17-year-old. This has been what our stories have been like. This is the nature of our news for the past couple of years.
Yeah.
As you said, going back to Malia Turner, this 13-year-old girl at this closed rec center. And once again, Sandtown, Winchester, everybody, which is where this 15-year-old was shot and killed yesterday, and the 13-year-old Malia Turner. This is the same Sandtown that 8 years ago was the kickoff of everything that we're seeing right now.
Yep.
It started with the death of Freddie Gray in Sandtown, and this is our reality, basically, since then.
Doesn't sound like much has changed in those 8 years.
In that community, after we had the President of the United States talk about Sandtown, Barack Obama, we had national news that the trucks were all in town from every major news entity. Bernie Sanders went walking down the streets in Sandtown and called it a third world area. All of that, and yet, if you were to drive there today, Bryan, I mean, literally, it's gotten worse.
Yeah.
It's not better. It's worse.
Maybe in 2 years, when it's the 10-year anniversary of the death of Freddie Gray, that there will be a national news. NBC News will come by. Lester Holt will stop by and look at where Sandtown, Winchester is 10 years later, and it will look exactly like it did in 2015, or close to it.
Where, though, is the urgency of Annapolis? And this is something we're going to ask and talk about today, 530 Club, Baltimore County Executive Johnny Olszewski. Tomorrow, Bryan, we have Howard County Executive Calvin Ball on, who most recently has joined the chorus, you want to call it a chorus, of those saying we've got to change these juvenile laws. Because in Howard County, they're facing issues with their juveniles when it comes to the implementation of this Juvenile Justice Reform Act and the Juvenile Interrogation Act. They're facing those. Everybody, Bryan, is facing it.
I know.
Everywhere.
I mean, a 15-year-old shot, and again, you don't know what happened.
Broad daylight.
All right. It's 4 o'clock in the afternoon. We got a kid at Dunbar's walking around with a gun and goes off. And how does it go off? I mean, either you're fooling around with it, you got it out in your hand, you're messing around with it, or you got it loaded and you don't have it, you know, stored it properly.
But the question you ask, Bryan, over and over again, where are they getting these guns? You keep asking, and you're not the only one, but you are mostly asking the question of all these policymakers, why aren't we determining the source of these
they
guns?
They should be, we don't know how old the kid at Dunbar is who shot himself.
He's a teenager.
But he should be grilled to no end to figure out where he got that gun from and go after him as well as the person who gave it to him.
Bring it down on whoever got the gun to him, whoever it was.
I mean, it's just, it's if guns is what we're going to talk about, then we have to put people who, and especially teenagers who carry the guns, and figure out where they're getting it from and go hard after them.
Hard.
And, you know, like I've said before, it's not the Gun Trace Task Force. We have to come up with a new name.
Yep.
But we need some kind of, you know, team that is looking into these things and do it in the right fashion, above board, transparency, but figure out where these guns are coming from and try to get people in jail as much as you possibly can for selling, giving, distributing guns to teenagers especially.
That is why when I saw this Friday, everybody, announcement by President Joe Biden, and we had members of Maryland's legislature and other folks from around the country there about this gun violence violence prevention office that he's having. Look, we aren't getting mass shootings, Brian, like, you know, what's happened in Stoneman Douglas or in Sandy Hook. But we have the accumulation of mass shootings all the time here in Baltimore. And there isn't the type of attention given to this crisis as it is to these other crises. And I think the bottom line is people have accommodated to it. It's normalized. It's become, you know, 15-year-old shot and killed, you know, it's Baltimore. And the fact that we're there is criminal in terms of a mindset. Well, you know, a kid shoots himself in front of Dumbo.
It doesn't make national news. And I get it why it doesn't make national news. But I do wonder, I mean, people are kind of starting to go, wow, Baltimore has 13 schools that don't have any kids that are proficient in math. It's starting to bubble up
right
across the country.
Make a connection.
But, yeah, I wonder, too, if they look at they go, wow, a 15-year-old got shot in the middle of the day, another teenager got shot himself at a high school. Like, you wonder if, like, other places would look at this and go, what the hell is going on in Baltimore? But for us, it's just, you know, another day. The Dunbar shooting didn't even make most of the news.
It didn't
newscasts.
Even make it. Didn't even make it. And that's why I look at our policymakers. I look at our school system people. I even look, Brian, at our ministers in the area. I'm telling you, and I'm not trying to glorify the past. Some people romanticize the past. If we'd had an inkling of anything that's going on for the past 2 years, Reverend Vernon Dobson, Reverend A.C.D. Vaughn, Reverend Arnold Howard, I can go off the list of ministers that would have been down in front of either, at the time, William Donald Schaefer's office, and then the transition to Kurt Schmoke in 1987 would have been down there saying, what the hell is going on?
Right.
We need more police protection. There would have been a palpable sense of urgency. And I just looked down the road, Brian, at Prince George's County. Look how Angela Alsobrooks and their police chief, Malik Aziz, act when one thing happens. They have one gun they captured off of a kid at the during the summer school program in Prince George's County Public Schools. And they put in a plastic book bags, clear, and weapons detection systems.
Right.
One gun.
I know.
They didn't wait for 14 or 15 or multiple incidences.
I know. You know what else is interesting, too, is that when you put a camera in front of people, or you go and you ask people, residents around wherever it is, if it's in West Baltimore, if it's in East Baltimore, in Dunbar, everyone says, this is ridiculous. This got to stop. Mom, what are we doing here? How does this happen? We got to figure out what's wrong with our kids. My wife, you know, works in the city. She says it's all what she says the ladies talk about is how bad the violence is and how crazy kids are right now. It's what everyone is talking about, citizens of Baltimore, right? And yet, it's just white noise for the most part.
We should replay Dr. Tom Scalia, the chief surgeon down at University of Maryland Shock Trauma Unit, Brian, when he painfully talked about what he has to witness on a regular basis, putting children back together again. And multiple times, kids coming on his operating table to put them back together again in shock trauma. Maybe they need to hear more of that to sensitize them as to what it's like when you send kids back out in the street with bullet wounds.
Yeah. And then the Lillian Jones Rec Center, twice now in 2 years, a spot where teenagers have been murdered, a 13-year-old and a 15-year-old.
And it's closed now, which once again tells you the condition of that particular community. We'll talk about this more with T.J. Smith later on in the show. I can't wait to talk with him about just the nature of the, like you say, Brian, the white noise that it's become in many ways.